Good morning. Before Mass, we'd like to go over a new communion song with you. We're just going to teach you the refrain. It's number 744, Set Your Heart on the Higher Gifts. So if you could open up your One in Faith songbooks to number 744, Set Your Heart on the Higher Gifts. We'll sing the refrain through once, and you can just listen to it. And then we'll do it a second time, and if you could try to join in with us the second time, we would appreciate that.
Good morning. Welcome to the Church of St. Patrick. Today we celebrate the fourth Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our second collection is to support the many projects of the Catholic Relief Home Missions. Please take a bulletin home with you. It lists our many parish activities. Kindly make sure all cell phones are turned off. Just as Jesus spoke to the crowd in the synagogue, he speaks to us here. Today, this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing. Our response ought to be different, however, than those who ran him out of town. Through the Holy Spirit, the Word of God is able to penetrate our hearts and transform us into missionary disciples of God's love. We remember at this Mass J. William Norton. Please stand, join our gathering hymn, 803, Gather as One, 803.
Together this morning as the family of God to celebrate this Eucharist and to be renewed in our relationship with Jesus. Let us take a moment and call to mind the times we failed to love and ask the Lord for his pardon. Lord Jesus, you are the Holy One of God. Lord, have mercy. Christ Jesus, you are the Son of God and the Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, your love and mercy are without end. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
grant us, Lord our God, that we may honor you with all our mind and love everyone in truth of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I dedicated you. A prophet to the nations, I appointed you. But you do gird your loins. Stand up and tell them all that I command you. Be not crushed on their account, as though I would leave you crushed before them. For it is I, this day, who have made you a fortified city, a pillar of iron, a wall of brass, against the whole land, against Judah's kings and princes, against its priests and its people. They will fight against you, but will not prevail over for you. For I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." The word of the Lord. Reading from the letter of Saint Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, love is patient, love is kind. It is not jealous, it is not pompous. It is not inflated, it is not rude, it does not seek its own interests. It is not quick-tempered. It does not brood over injury. It does not rejoice over wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. If there are prophecies, they will be brought to nothing. If tongues, they will cease. If knowledge, it will be brought to nothing. For we know partially and we prophesy partially. But when perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I used to talk like a child, think as a child, reason as a child. When I became a man, I put aside childish things. At present, we see indistinctly as in a mirror, but then face to face. At present, I know partially, then I shall know fully, as I am fully known. So faith, hope, and love remain these three, but the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Jesus began speaking in the synagogue, saying, "Today this scripture passage is fulfilled in your hearing." And all spoke highly of him, and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They also asked, "Isn't this the son of Joseph?" He said to them, "Surely you will quote me this proverb, 'Physician, cure yourself,' and say, 'Do here in your native place the things that we heard were done in Capernaum.'" And he said, "Amen, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own native place. Indeed, I tell you, there were many widows in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the sky was closed for 3.5 years, and a severe famine spread over the entire land. To none of these that Elijah was sent, but only to a widow in Zarephath, in the land of Sidon. Again, there were many lepers in Israel during the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, but only Naaman the Syrian. When the people in the synagogue heard this, they were all filled with fury. They rose up and drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill in which their town had been built, to hurl him down headlong. But Jesus passed through the midst of them and went away." The Gospel of the Lord. And he opened the scroll to the passage of Isaiah that read, "The Messiah will bring good news to the poor, set captives free, announce a year of salvation So Jesus read from the book of Isaiah all these promises that would come with the Messiah. And this would be wonderful to behold. And people were excited. They honored him. They shout for joy that Jesus would bring all these wonderful things to their homeland. In fact, he said, and they saw that he was curing miracles in other towns and cities. And so they expected that to happen in their town. And so they're excited that the Lord had come to visit them. They're excited that he has entered the synagogue. And he offers these words of God, helping them understand that the word of God was living, was moving, was active. The poor will hear the good news. The blind will see. So the good news was that God's love is very powerful and active and is moving. And then Jesus adds a little bit more to that today. We read the next page in the Bible in Luke's Gospel. And then Jesus says, all these good things are going to happen. And on top of it, God's love is for everybody. Now they're mad. Why would they be mad over that? Why would they be upset over God's love that reaches out to all people of all religions? Why would that upset them? God's love is something good and holy. It upset them because they thought they were privileged. We are the Jewish people. We are privileged. God's miracles should happen here in our synagogue, in our place of worship, nowhere else. And so they're upset with Jesus, and their opinion quickly turned. His teaching was just a little bit too much for them to behold. That God's love is for all people. And so they want to throw him out of the town, throw him over the, down the cliff. And Jesus slips out of their sight. As we contemplate this gospel today, we see that Jesus never came back to that town. According to Luke's gospel, he never came back to that town. But we can reflect on something very powerful here today. And that's God's love is great. God's love is beyond what we can imagine. It is holy. It is life-giving. It is life-changing. When we open our heart to the love of God. We heard in our second reading St. Paul talking, a lot of times couples choose that reading for their wedding. And it's a beautiful reading for a wedding. Love is kind, love is patient. It's describing God's incredible love that's beyond our understanding. And it's an invitation for us to share that love, to live that love, and to be welcoming towards one another, even people of different race and religion and gender, that we are open to God's love, that we bring God's love to those relationships, to those situations. Right now, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, has initiated back in the fall what is called a synod. And a synod is a teaching. It's a journey to walk with one another, to learn something new about our religion, about our faith. And very uniquely, those meetings usually took place with priests and bishops and the Pope. But this year, this synod is different than any other synod. We're invited to open, the priest is invited to open the meeting, but the meeting is really to listen to the lay people. And not just to Catholics. The Pope said to all people, for we're all children of God. And so we're going to invite the Protestants. We're invite the Jewish people, the Muslim people, to come and to be part of our listening sessions. So if you're married to a non-Catholic, you're married to a Protestant, this is something you could do together, to come to a listening session and share in some of the questions that are put forth. The same questions that will be asked here at St. Pat's are the same questions that are answered in Brazil, in Africa, in Canada, around the globe. Our next listening session is tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. It should only go about an hour or so. But I want everyone to know that everyone's welcome. Those who come to church every Sunday, and those who have fallen away. If you have a family member that's kind of drifted away from the faith a little bit, invite them to come to that meeting so that they can be listened to, so that their voice can be heard, so that the Spirit of God may work in our coming together at St. Pat's, but also around the world. God's love is more than we could ever imagine. And for us to open our hearts to experience that love, His Spirit will move within us, and His Spirit will call us to new growth and newness of relationship with Christ. So let us be open to the possibility of new thoughts being shared, thoughts being listened to, and thoughts that will come together and maybe even bless us beyond what we could imagine. As we celebrate our Eucharist then this Sunday, we listen to the prophetic role of the prophets of the Old Testament and the prophetic role of Jesus, who invites us to come and see what He is really about, to be challenged by His teachings, to love all people, to respect all religions, and to hold them in the palm of our hand with good faith. Let us ask the Lord to bless our journey, our faith journey, that along the way we will listen to one another, we will be kind towards one another, and most especially, we will share faith, hope, and love. St. Paul tells us the greatest of that is love. God's love for you and for me, God's love for one another, God's love that takes us to a new understanding of what it means to be His sons and daughters of the living God. Together, let us proclaim our profession of faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For our sin and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life in the world to come. Amen. God knew us and our needs before we were born, with hearts ready to receive God's blessing and greet confidence. Let us bring our needs and the needs of the world before Him.
That the Lord will bless the efforts of the Universal Church to send out missionary disciples, ready to share God's goodness. Lord, in your mercy. That all government leaders will have the gifts of faith, hope, and love, and acknowledge God and be of true service to those that they govern. Lord, in your mercy. That God, who knows and loves us from the womb, will inspire and sustain our work to eliminate abortion and the circumstances that lead to it. Lord, in your mercy. That the Lord will call all in need of forgiveness and reconciliation to repentance and bless them with healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
That the Holy Spirit will help all gathered here today to see and truly know the great plans Jesus has for us. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
That God will grant the sick and those who care for them, and those who have asked us to pray for them, healing, relief, and peace. Lord, in your mercy. That all who have died marked with the cross of faith, and those who have died unremembered and unmourned, and Deacon Robert Rogers, Frank Milano, Delroy Wolf, Pamela Purcell, Mildred Gabardi, Carolyn Fay, and Robert Lazarchuk, that they will feast with the angels and the saints in the presence of God the Father. Lord, in your mercy. That J. William Norton, whom we remember at this Mass today, will always share in the eternal banquet. Lord, in your mercy. And for those petitions we hold in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Father, as you answer our prayers this day, give us the faith and hope we need in our lives. And above all, let us grow in your love, which lasts forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please join in singing our preparation hymn, Be Not Afraid, number 774, 774.
These offerings of our service. Be pleased to receive them, we pray. pray, and transform them into the sacrament of our redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, mighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by his birth, he brought renewal to humanity's fallen state, and by his suffering, canceled out our sins. By his rising from the dead, he has opened the way to eternal life. By ascending to you, O Father, he has unlocked the gates of heaven. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. Present in our midst, when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, you led to his passion, death on the cross, to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand. Proclaim the work of your love until he comes again. And we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us. And grant that, by the power of the Spirit of your love, you may be counted now until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, whose body and blood we have communion. So, having called us to your table, Lord, confirm us in unity, so that together with Francis our Pope, Alfred our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and your entire people, as we walk your ways with faith and hope, we may strive to bring joy and trust to the world. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Permit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection, give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place, live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, Saint Patrick, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
I leave you. My peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us acknowledge that peace with those around us.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, have mercy.
Please join in singing our communion hymn, number 744, Set Your Hearts on Higher Gifts, 744.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Nourished by these redeeming gifts, we pray, O Lord, that through this help to eternal salvation, true faith may ever increase. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A couple brief announcements for our parish family. As I mentioned earlier, the next synod meeting will be tomorrow night at 6 o'clock in the parish hall. All are welcome. We'll probably have a couple more listening sessions during the month of February. Two events this week, liturgically. On Wednesday, February 2nd, we'll have Candlemas Day, the blessing of candles, and the Feast of the Presentation of Our Lord. And then on Thursday night, the traditional blessing of throats on the Feast of St. Blaise, and that blessing will take place after the 6 p.m. Mass on Thursday. Please check the bulletin. We begin Catholic Schools Week today, and check the bulletin for the times of the open houses, both at Nativity and at Blessed Virgin Mary, and all the wonderful things that are planned for this week. May God's blessing come upon our staff, our catechist at Nativity, and Blessed Virgin Mary, the catechist. You might have heard of this before. This happened last year. It was called Cooks with Collars. So all the priests were invited to cook something, videotape it, and then people can call in and vote for the best creation. So we have asked Father Barnabas this year to cook something exotic that can only be bought and it can only be found in Tanzania. So for the first day, we were leading the whole diocese, all the churches. We were number one on the first day that it opened on Friday. And so you can vote for his creation by going online, and please see the bulletin for the details for that, or you can drop off your donation in the parish office. Cooks with Collars. It will go through the whole month of February, and at the end of the month, they'll declare the winner, the one with the priest with the most votes. I was the annoying pastor. I kept asking, is it food yet? Is it ready yet? So you can see our video online and vote for your favorite cook. Next weekend is spaghetti dinner, and so get a night off from cooking. Please enjoy the wonderful spaghetti and meatballs made by our parishioners. So that's next weekend, spaghetti dinner, Sunday. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As Mass is ended, let us go in God's peace.
Thanks be to God.
Saint Michael, your archangel, defend us in our battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God come to you and humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, cast into us safely, and all evil spirits, from our God and our seeking to do the most.
Please join in singing our recessional hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, number 743, 743.